voice that cries out in the silence.
After baptism, after being tested by Satan 40 days and nights in the wilderness, after John the Baptist was arrested, Jesus went to Galilee, preaching the message of God. Now, Mark has skipped about a year of Jesus' public ministry in Judea. During that time, Jesus began to gain followers as he proclaimed the kingdom of God. Our lesson starts with Jesus walking along the beach of the Lake of Galilee. He saw Simon and his brother Andrew plying their trade of net fishing. Jesus said to them, "Come with me. I will show you how to catch men and women." And they didn't ask a question. They dropped their nets and followed. A few yards down the beach, he saw the brothers James and John, Zebedee's sons, in the boat mending their fish nets. Jesus made the same offer, and immediately they left their father, the boat, and the hired hands and followed. His invitation then and now is twofold. One, to follow Jesus, challenging them to be his disciples, to learn from him. Two, become fishers of people. Their abilities and skills for fishing would be transferred to targeting and reaching people in Jesus' name. He would train them with knowledge and provide them with opportunity. That same challenge calls us today. We must follow Jesus and use the knowledge, skills, and ability God has bestowed upon us to bring people to him. Through his word, he will train us, and in our daily walk, he will provide the opportunity for discipleship. When read in secular vernacular, the second part of our lesson is perplexing. Jesus here requires every disciple to hate those whom he elsewhere commands us to love. We are told that to be his disciple, we must hate, and not just anyone. Hate our own fathers, mothers, wives, children, brothers, sisters. Elsewhere, we are told we can't even hate our enemies. How then can Jesus command us to hate those whom we love? Let's put this scripture in context and we'll see the nuanced meaning of the word. At the time this word was spoken, a large crowd of people are following Jesus. Some of these people were merely curious about Jesus, his miracles, and his teachings. They were more interested in being around this rising star than following his teachings. Jesus wanted to weed out those who followed him for superficial reasons. So he turned to the great multitude and laid out the demands for discipleship. The word hate is used differently here. Jesus is not saying despise our closest kindred. Rather, he is saying we must have more love and commitment for God's work than our family, willing to sacrifice relationships. And so he says to this mixed crowd, anyone who comes to me but refuses to let go of their father, mother, spouse, children, brother, sisters, yes, even one's own self, cannot be a true disciple committed to God's work. Anyone who won't shoulder his own cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Discipleship is more than just a joyous feeling. It is a decision about a commitment to self-sacrifice. Jesus gives two examples. A builder of a tower will first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete the project or risk community ridicule. A king will sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to defeat a force of 20,000. If he cannot, he will ask for terms of peace. In both examples, the builder and the king can fail to finish and end in humiliation. Discipleship is a long-term commitment, not a short-term thing. It is made after an individual assessment and a commitment to self-sacrifice. Jesus wanted all men to know in advance that the price of discipleship was high. Enthusiasm and eagerness can be now, but Golgotha was coming. Jesus does not want us following him without knowing that there will be a sacrifice that sets us apart from all the rest of the world around us. Jesus wants us to choose his discipleship purposefully rather than unthinkingly following after him. Jesus was not after a large following of uncommitted followers. He was not pressing them for a quick decision. In his illustration, Jesus said that each man should have first sat down and considered what to do, making a reasoned decision. Finally, Jesus wants us to be willing to depend on him. To leave family and home means that we must depend fully upon Christ. Our commitment and strong faith grows greater as we walk with Christ without any other safety net other than him, knowing that that is enough. That's the lesson for this week. Have a great week. Bye.